from war and peace, Downton still stands and the Crawleys are still in it. When they see it, Granny or Papa?
I should think they'll howl at the moon in unison.
What in God's name is this? Well, I never.
Where did this come from?
Well, I ordered it on the way through in London, picked it up on the way back. It's an AC.
Well, at least it's English.
Welcome. Spec me.
How's that? Can everybody hear me just fine? Well, thank you very much, Andy, for that wonderful introduction and for having me here today. I am from Tacoma, Washington. America's Car Museum is located in Tacoma, Washington, and I am the collections manager, and I get asked a lot how much money I collect every year, which is, my job is not collecting bad debts. I take care of the car collection and all of our, also our ephemera, like our fuel pumps and neon signs and other automobile items on display. We have over 300 vehicles on display at any given time in the museum. Our museum owns about 267 vehicles. And since I've been with the museum, I've had over 800 vehicles go through my care. So it's kind of a big thing to do with all these different eras. I love cars. I've been a car spotter since I was a little girl growing up in Southern California, where the car culture was quite prevalent, and it translated into my adult life with movies. And actually my husband and I compete when we go out to movies or we see television shows where they have vintage vehicles, we see who's the first one to spot what it is. So I've been also a big fan of public television, PBS, and the Masterpiece series for many years. So when Downton Abbey came on television, I was really thrilled to see we had the added benefit of having so many magnificent cars featured in every episode. Anytime they were outside, there was a car involved. There was a car in the background. There were numerous cars around. So today what I'm going to do is we're going to talk about some of the star cars that we have, that you see frequently in the program. And if you've never seen the program before and you're just a car person, we're going to talk about the cars and their history. And I have some insider information about some of the actual cars that were used, because they have an interesting history of their own. And if you're a Downton Abbey fan, I hope that, if you're going to watch the show, because I understand over Thanksgiving weekend, your local public television stations are going to be playing a Downton Abbey marathon. So if you're going to power watch it over the Thanksgiving weekend, over the turkey, you'll have an additional dimension to your watching pleasure. So I'm not going to be able to touch on every single car that has featured, every single mark that we see featured in the show, because if I delved really deeply into every single one, we'd be here till Christmas, so I can't do that. So I'm going to just touch on them. I'm going to talk about the people that owned them, the people that drove them. They're not necessarily all one and the same, of course. And we're going to talk about cars in how they relate in the time, the changing periods, the changing economic times, and the changing social times that happened in England as well as America. I'm also going to relate to some of the cars that crossed the pond, shall we say, and our American aristocracy here in at the same time during the Downton period. I'm going to start here with a picture of the Abbey. And the reason why I want to show you this picture is it's a view that you don't see. The one down below is the one that you see all the time from the ground level of the two limos coming and going and coming and going, or the dog walking along. You always see this view. But this is a picture of Blenheim Castle. It is a real place. And that's what's really fun about this program, is that it covers real places, real times, real things that happened in history with real people. But the people in the series, of course, are fictitious. It's a wonderful story of a family. And the Blenheim Castle is someplace you can actually visit now. But the reason why I want to show you this one is because you can see the stables. And during this time, in the background there, you can see there were where the horses and carriages would have been kept and taken care of. And from about 1900 to 1910, anybody that was owning a horse and carriage had stables. They had transitioned into the motor age already and had a car. And generally speaking, they would take a little portion of their stable and turn it into their garage. And so when you're watching the show and you see Tom Branson, their chauffeur, a professional driver, that this is probably where he would have been doing most of his work. Now, Downton Abbey, as you know, the Downton story starts at the sinking of the Titanic. Just to give you a little background, when the Titanic sank, the heir apparent to the Downton fortune died along with the sinking of the ship, and that left everybody in an uproar because Lord Grantham only had daughters, and at that time they could not inherit property, so they had no idea what their future might bring in, the future of the abbey. So it goes from 1912, and it runs six seasons through 1925. So this is the period of time I call the Downton period, and we're going to cover the automotive period about that time. Actually, the first 30 years of automobiles from the turn of the century to about 1930, and you'll know why when I start talking about the years of the vehicles. You know, the cars were just not another bit of set dressing. The cars were actually another set of characters. I've said that many times because not only do they drive the story along, if you pardon the pun, but they also influence the characters and how they made their decisions and how they interacted with each other. A lot of scenes took place in the cars, and the cars moved the story along and helped the characters make their decisions on how they were going to run their lives. Also, in this time of Downton Abbey, there was a heavy class structure, a very, very well-ingrained class structure of the wealthy all the way down to the servant class or the upstairs, downstairs, and everything in between. This was long-standing. It was very, very deeply ingrained in the social structure. Unlike here in America, I think during this time we had our social structure may have been more on economic lines, but we could interact with people within different social structures and economic lines without being ostracized. Where in this period of time, you really didn't fraternize with the help. You didn't, if you were a wealthy person, if you were a noble person who lost your money or you were no longer wealthy, you could still hop around for your other relatives in that area. And as long as you kept your reputation intact, you were welcome. But generally speaking, there was nothing that in the early parts of the show the Downton period where people fraternized with each other in different class structures. So just like the class structure in the series, the cars also can represent a class structure. And we'll start with maybe the professional class and in the working class area, and a little higher with the taxis and the hired cabs that you'll see. This car is shown fairly frequently throughout the series, and if you spot it, I want you to know what it is. It's the only taxi cab. Pretty much you see it in coming up to Downton. You also see it in the London scenes, and it's a 1912, in real life, it's a 1912 Yannick 14 horsepower taxi. These were French cars. It's spelled UNIC, and I'm assuming it's pronounced Yannick because they said that they were trying to build a car that was, or excuse me, unique, because they were trying to build a car that was unique. So these cars were two and four cylinder engines, very light cars, that and all professional vehicles only. I have another picture of it driving up into Downton with the porters, you know, coming up and lying in the one in the background there is a little crawly bullnose. You see that quite a few times throughout the series. Also in this one, the crawlies are English made. And note, it's a Crawley, but it has nothing to do with the Crawley family in the series. We also have, representing perhaps the working class and maybe the servant class, would be the Model T Ford. We see an awful lot of Model Ts and Morrises running through the background that are trucks, lightweight cars that are delivery vehicles, or they're really the working backbone of this time period. And you see them numerous times, just about every episode. We also have the middle class represented in some of the sedans and hired vehicles. Again, like I said, the hired cars like the taxis, because the middle class, they may not own a car, but they could travel. And if they could travel, they could hire a car for their needs, going from one point to another, or going from the train station to points that, beyond. And then our professional vehicles, such as the ambulances during World War I sequences you see in the series. This is actually a very nice Model T or TT, the ambulance. And I also understand that Studebaker, I'm going to mention Studebaker because there's none shown in the show, but during this period of time, Studebaker did fill orders to the British government for war use, wagons as well as a lot of cars. So unfortunately, I don't have any pictures of them from the show, but it was a significant amount of vehicles that went over for World War I. Also, this is a beautiful car. I'm going to point it out to you because Thornycroft is a British maker of commercial vehicles. These were large commercial vehicles, and someone took this Thornycroft bus and has restored it and uses it. I've seen it in a couple of programs, but this one is featured. It's kind of in the background in the town sequences when you see them going to town in early part of the series one and two. And then, of course, representing the wealthy, the established class, the nobility are our limousines, our Rolls Royces, a little sunbeam there that are frequently seen driving up to the Abbey. But you know, before we go on, I'm going to talk about a car that you don't see this one particularly. You're going to have to look for this one. So that's why I put this is a little scavenger hunt car that if you're watching the show, I want you to keep an eye out for this little Daimler. Because when I saw it come on the screen, I recognized it immediately. And I thought to myself, and you know, Julian Fellowes and the directors were so, if you saw the costumes in there that are on display, you could really agree with me that the attention to detail was marvelous. And it was the same with the cars. Having this car in the program, even if it's just in the background or a secondary car, was totally appropriate because it's a very significant vehicle in British history, in English automotive history. So the Daimler, the car that you see, is a 1911 Daimler 20 horsepower Landaulet. But Daimler Company was considered the first automobile company in the United Kingdom. Daimler Company Limited was incorporated in 1896 using Gottlieb Daimler's engine design and name under license. But by 1907, the company partnered with American Charles Knight to develop a sleeve valve engine to replace Daimler's aging design. Although characterized by high oil consumption and a smoky exhaust, the noticeably new motor proved durable, and subsequently all Daimler cars of this era were the Knight sleeve valve engine. And you know, the first time I saw a sleeve valve engine was at a Concours many years ago, getting an award, driving across the dais to get its award, and it was a Knight sleeve valve engine that was smoking like you would not believe, and I had never seen one before in operation at that time, and I thought the car needed a ring job. It was smoking so heavy. And so I leaned over to my husband and I said, geez, you know, that car is really smoking a lot. There must be something wrong. Just as the announcer who was giving the award out said, well, and he explained the Knight sleeve valve engine and how smoky they were. So I'm glad I didn't say it out loud. I would have really been embarrassed. But the one also, I want you a little history about this particular car is kind of fun that I was able to turn up some background on it. It is a car that was originally owned by a grandson, one of the grandsons of Queen Victoria. And the current owner lets it out quite frequently for film and movie use. It was seen in other shows such as Mr. Selfridge. I don't know if you've watched that. It's another PBS program. And Paradise End. And the only picture that I could grab a shot from that was a little better than the other two I had was this one with Jeremy Previn, who plays Mr. Selfridge, sitting in the back seat. This is a car, the reason how I spotted it, this is a car that I have on display in my museum that is in the America's Car Museum collection. It is a 1913 Daimler Type 20, and as you can see, it's very familiar, similar in look. It is an open car. The other one is a closed touring vehicle.
From war and peace, Downton still stands, and the Crawleys are still in it.
best when they see it, Granny or Papa.
I should think they'll howl at the moon in unison.
What in God's name is this? Well, I never.
Where did this come from?
I ordered it on the way through in London, picked it up on the way back. It's an AC.
Well, at least it's English.
Welcome.
How's that? Everybody hear me just fine? Well, thank you very much, Andy, for that wonderful introduction and for having me here today. I am from Tacoma, Washington. America's Car Museum is located in Tacoma, Washington, and I am the collections manager, and I get asked a lot how much money I collect every year, which is, my job is not collecting bad debts. I take care of the car collection and all of our, also our ephemera, like our fuel pumps and neon signs and other automobile items on display. We have over 300 vehicles on display at any given time in the museum. Our museum owns about 267 vehicles. And since I've been with the museum, I've had over 800 vehicles go through my care. So it's kind of a big thing to do with all these different eras. I love cars. I've been a car spotter since I was a little girl growing up in Southern California, where the car culture was quite prevalent, and it translated into my adult life with movies. And actually, my husband and I compete when we go out to movies, or we see television shows where they have vintage vehicles. We see who's the first one to spot what it is. So, I've also been a big fan of public television, PBS, and the Masterpiece series for many years. So when Downton Abbey came on television, I was really thrilled to see we had the added benefit of having so many magnificent cars featured in every episode. Anytime they were outside, there was a car involved. There was a car in the background. There were numerous cars around. So today what I'm going to do is we're going to talk about some of the star cars that we have, that you see frequently in the program. And if you've never seen the program before and you're just a car person, we're going to talk about the cars and their history, and I have some insider information about some of the actual cars that were used, because they have an interesting history of their own. And if you're a Downton Abbey fan, I hope that, if you're going to power watch the show, because I understand over Thanksgiving weekend, your local public television stations are going to be playing a Downton Abbey marathon. So if you're going to power watch it over the Thanksgiving weekend, over the turkey, you'll have an additional dimension to your watching pleasure. So I'm not going to be able to touch on every single car that has featured, every single mark that we see featured in the show, because if I delved really deeply into every single one, we'd be here till Christmas, so I can't do that. So I'm going to just touch on them. I'm going to talk about the people that owned them, the people that drove them. They're not necessarily all one and the same, of course. And we're going to talk about cars in how they relate in the time, the changing periods, the changing economic times, and the changing social times that happened in England as well as America. I'm also going to relate to some of the cars that crossed the pond, shall we say, and our American aristocracy here in at the same time during the Downton period. I'm going to start here with a picture of the Abbey, and the reason why I want to show you this picture is it's a view that you don't see. The one down below is the one that you see all the time from the ground level of the two limos coming and going and coming and going, or the dog walking along. You always see this view. But this is a picture of Blenheim Castle. It is a real place, and that's what's really fun about this program, is that it covers real places, real times, real things that happened in history with real people. But the people in the series, of course, are fictitious. It's a wonderful story of a family. And the Blenheim Castle is someplace you can actually visit now. But the reason why I want to show you this one is because you can see the stables. And during this time, in the background there, you can see there were where the horses and carriages would have been kept and taken care of. And from about 1900 to 1910, anybody that was owning a horse and carriage had stables. They had transitioned into the motor age already and had a car. And generally speaking, they would take a little portion of their stable and turn it into their garage. And so when you're watching the show and you see Tom Branson, their chauffeur, professional driver, that this is probably where he would have been doing most of his work. Now, Downton Abbey, as you know, the Downton story starts at the sinking of the Titanic. Just to give you a little background, when the Titanic sank, the heir apparent to the Downton fortune died along with the sinking of the ship, and that left everybody in an uproar, because the heir was not Lord Grantham only had daughters, and at that time they could not inherit property, so they had no idea what their future might bring and the future of the future of the Abbey. So it goes from 1912 and it runs six seasons through 1925. So this is the period of time I call the Downton period, and we're going to cover the automotive period about that time. Actually, the first 30 years of automobiles from the turn of the century to about 1930, and you'll know why when I start talking about the years of the vehicles. You know, the cars were just not another bit of set dressing. The cars were actually another set of characters. I've said that many times, because not only do they drive the story along, if you pardon the pun, but they also influence the characters and how they made their decisions and how they interacted with each other. A lot of scenes took place in the cars, and the cars moved the story along and helped the characters make their decisions on how they were going to run their lives. Also in this time of Downton Abbey, there was a heavy class structure, a very, very well ingrained class structure of the wealthy all the way down to the servant class or the upstairs, downstairs, and everything in between. This was longstanding. It was very, very deeply ingrained in the social structure. Unlike here in America, I think during this time we had our social structure may have been more on economic lines, but we could interact with people within different social structures and economic lines without being ostracized. Where in this period of time, you really didn't fraternize with the help. You didn't, if you were a wealthy person, if you were a noble person who lost your money or you were no longer wealthy, you could still hop around for your other relatives in that area. And as long as you kept your reputation intact, you were welcome. But generally speaking, there was nothing that in the early parts of the show the Downton period where people fraternized with each other in different class structures. So just like the class structure in the series, the cars also can represent a class structure. And we'll start with maybe the professional class and in the working class area, and a little higher with the taxis and the hired cabs that you'll see. This car is shown fairly frequently throughout the series, and if you spot it, I want you to know what it is. It's the only taxi cab. Pretty much you see it in coming up to Downton. You also see it in the London scenes, and it's a 1912, in real life, it's a 1912 unique 14 horsepower taxi. These were French cars. It's spelled UNIC, and I'm assuming it's pronounced unique because they said that they were trying to build a car that was, unique, because they were trying to build a car that was unique. So these cars were 2- and 4-cylinder engines, very light cars, and all professional vehicles only. I have another picture of it driving up into Downton with the porters, coming up and lying in the one in the background there is a little crawly bullnose. You see that quite a few times throughout the series. Also in this one, the crawlies are English made. And note, it's a Crawley, but it has nothing to do with the Crawley family in the series. We also have, representing perhaps the working class and maybe the servant class, would be the Model T Ford. We see an awful lot of Model Ts and Morrises running through the background that are trucks, lightweight cars that are delivery vehicles, or they're really the working backbone of this time period. And you see them numerous times, just about every episode. We also have the middle class represented in some of the sedans and hired vehicles. Again, like I said, the hired cars like the taxis, because the middle class, they may not own a car, but they could travel. And if they could travel, they could hire a car for their needs, going from one point to another, or going from the train station to points that, beyond. And then our professional vehicles, such as the ambulances during World War I sequences you see in the series. This is actually a very nice Model T or TT, the ambulance. And I also understand that Studebaker, I'm going to mention Studebaker because there's none shown in the show, but during this period of time, Studebaker did fill orders to the British government for war use, wagons as well as a lot of cars. So unfortunately, I don't have any pictures of them from the show, but it was a significant amount of vehicles that went over for World War I. Also, this is a beautiful car. I'm going to point it out to you because Thornycroft is a British maker of commercial vehicles. These were large commercial vehicles, and someone took this Thornycroft bus and has restored it and uses it. I've seen it in a couple of programs, but this one is featured. It's kind of in the background in the town sequences when you see them going to town in early part of the series 1 and 2. And then, of course, representing the wealthy, the established class, the nobility are our limousines, our Rolls Royces, a little sunbeam there that are frequently seen driving up to the Abbey. But you know, before we go on, I'm going to talk about a car that you don't see this one particularly. You're going to have to look for this one. So that's why I put this. This is a little scavenger hunt car that, if you're watching the show, I want you to keep an eye out for this little Daimler. Because when I saw it come on the screen, I recognized it immediately, and I thought to myself, and you know, Julian Fellowes and the directors were so, if you saw the costumes in there that are on display, you could really agree with me that the attention to detail was marvelous. And it was the same with the cars. Having this car in the program, even if it's just in the background or a secondary car, was totally appropriate because it's a very significant vehicle in British history, in English automotive history. So the Daimler, the car that you see, is a 1911 Daimler 20 horsepower Landaulet. But Daimler Company was considered the first automobile company in the United Kingdom. Daimler Company Limited was incorporated in 1896 using Gottlieb Daimler's engine design and name under license. But by 1907, the company partnered with American Charles Knight to develop a sleeve valve engine to replace Daimler's aging design. Although characterized by high oil consumption and a smoky exhaust, the noticeably new motor proved durable, and subsequently all Daimler cars of this era were the Knight sleeve valve engine. And you know, the first time I saw a sleeve valve engine was at a Concours many years ago, getting an award, driving across the dais to get its award, and it was a Knight sleeve valve engine that was smoking like you would not believe, and I had never seen one before in operation at that time. And I thought the car needed a ring job. It was smoking so heavy. And so I leaned over to my husband and I said, geez, you know, that car is really smoking a lot. There must be something wrong. Just as the announcer who was giving the award out said, well, and he explained the Knight sleeve valve engine and how smoky they were. So I'm glad I didn't say it out loud. I would have really been embarrassed. But the one also, I want you a little history about this particular car is kind of fun that I was able to turn up some background on it. It is a car that was originally owned by a grandson, one of the grandsons of Queen Victoria. And the current owner lets it out quite frequently for film and movie use. It was seen in other shows such as Mr. Selfridge. I don't know if you've watched that. It's another PBS program. And Paradise End. And the only picture that I could grab a shot from that was a little better than the other two I had was this one with Jeremy Previn, who plays Mr. Selfridge, sitting in the back seat. This is a car, the reason how I spotted it, this is a car that I have on display in my museum that is in the America's Car Museum collection. It is a 1913 Daimler Type 20, and as you can see, it's very familiar, similar in look. It is an open car. The other one is a closed,
beautiful example
touring
of a vehicle.
British brass era vehicle. And you can't see it here, but the gas tank is in the back, very open, and it's brass. The whole tank is brass. It's beautiful. Before we move on to even more of the luxury cars, I wanted to stop and talk about something that caught my attention quite early on. I just the sheer number of Model Ts that you see running around in the background made me wonder if you know, why were there so many Model Ts? They were so careful to be appropriate in the amount of cars that they showed in the show and the type of cars, but why were all these Model Ts running around all the time? I mean, one of the Tom Branson and the other people in the series actually drive a little pickup truck on to take care of the estates. So I went to look at this as far as English and Model Ts and discovered that, you know, it's really the Model Ts that we see in the show, let me see if I get that to change, there we go, is a real testament to Henry Ford and how global his reach and plan was for the Model T. He didn't just make an affordable car for American use, he immediately reached out to a global plan for his Model T in exporting them to other countries. And he very early on employed the knockdown kit process for the car, meaning that the kit could be taken completely apart and shipped overseas, all the parts, and this is a vintage photo of a Model T shipment, and very inexpensively shipped to other plants that he set up in other countries, and then assembled there. He could do that very affordably, very economically, and still keep the cost of the vehicle affordable for the masses. As a matter of fact, the Ford Model T is the first automobile to have been simultaneously manufactured in multiple countries as well as multiple states in the United States. The Ford Model T is between 1919 and 1921, Ford Britain, it was set up by Henry Ford, produced 33,600 cars. So it's 1919 to 1921, so it's post-World War I into the beginning of the 1920s. The English automaker Morris, by comparison, during that same period, produced 5,280 cars. Morris did not overtake Model T in production until 1924. So having all these American Ford Model Ts depicted throughout the program is completely appropriate for the Downton period. As a matter of fact, Henry Ford, a docent came up to me and told me this story the other day. He said Henry Ford liked to tell the story about a farmer who told him he wanted to be buried in his Model T because it was the only car that got him out of every hole he got stuck into. In effect, by the mid-1920s, about the time that the Downton Abbey period ended, more than half the world's cars were nearly identical Model Ts. This car up here is one that I have in the collection. I love this little, it's a beautifully restored Model T pickup truck. They made them in the latter part of the production of Model Ts. And this is one that is used, a picture of the one that Tom Branson drives around on. You see it a lot in the series. They're very, very similar, except one's got right-hand and one's got left-hand drive. So let's talk about Lord Grantham. This gentleman is the Lord of the Manor. He is the head of the Crawley family. He was a gentleman that was born into his wealth, his land, and his power. His title dates back to 1700 when the Earl of Grantham was named by King George III. I didn't know he had a backstory, but he really does. By the time he inherited his wealth and income, the estates were not able to fully maintain the family in the way they were accustomed. So his fortunate marriage to Cora, an American heiress, helped keep Downton into the lifestyle that they were accustomed. Lord Grantham grew up in the horse and carriage age, and as we know, and of course being right here in Studebaker country, early vehicles derived much of their practices, their styling, and their language from the horse and buggy era. Luxury coaches were hand-built, and the same marketing and sales practices, coach manufacturing trends, and styling transitioned right into the automotive era. Terms such as brougham and coupe and cabriolet first were attributed to horse-drawn coaches and wagons. So, and similarly, some of these terms, I'm going to show you, this is a wagon that was shown in Downton Abbey at the top. It's in, I think it's in series 1 and 2. You can see it running around in the background. But in cars, we have a dashboard. And a dashboard, also on a wagon, was a board that was put up to dash away all the foreign material that would have been kicked up by the horses. And of course, in our dashboards today, we have a glove box. Well, the glove box, of course, was a little box that was put underneath the seat, generally, of a carriage. And oddly enough, would carry the driver's gloves. On the back of the wagon, you'll see back here, we have handles the footmen would stand and hang on, perhaps, and if they were lucky, they had a board to sit on, and that board was called the rumble. The rumble seat transitioned right into automotive manufacturing, and we could buy cars with rumble seats here in the United States until about 1939 on American models, and in England, they were called a dickey seat. The rumble seat is a dickey seat, and you could get automobiles with dickey seats up until 1949. The last car was a Triumph with a dickey seat. It was actually an aluminum-bodied car, and I understand the bodies were made by melted down parts from World War II engines. They were aluminum that they scavenged or recycled, I should say. So, and you know, the thing about Lord Grantham again, I got to hit the right button, there we go. Right here, I wanted to mention, because if you want to see a rumble car with a rumble seat, there's one in the museum, this beautiful Studebaker President, all-weather roadster is one that does have a rumble seat. It's in the museum today, and I hope you'll stop by and take a look at it. The Studebaker Presidents were the premier vehicle by Studebaker, beautiful, beautiful cars. Absolutely gorgeous styling. They are considered full classics by the Classic Car Club of America, and they actually campaigned a lot of the presidents in racing circuit, and they set numerous records that held for 10 years or more. They're elegant, sporty, with a really powerful engine, and I think this is one that Tom Branson, our chauffeur, probably would love to have driven. Speaking of chauffeurs, Lord Grantham and his never learned to drive a car, and he never even would have entertained the thought of learning to drive. As a matter of fact, he and his peers would not even have been comfortable driving their own carriage, much less a car. It was a very rare for a man of that age bracket to wanted to drive a vehicle. Lord Granthams of the world employed chauffeurs to handle the cars for them. They needed to be very knowledgeable of the operation and maintenance of the car. They needed to be able to keep them in at-ready status. They needed to know how to start them, how to deal with the carburation systems. All these things were all new technology for this time. They had to keep them polished and ready to go. And if they broke down on the side of the road, they had to be able to repair them. So these gentlemen, these young men, were quite talented for their time and very much in demand. And professional drivers, as a matter of fact, were very much in demand. But, you know, the thing of it is that during this time period, if you want to kind of put it into perspective, let's take a look at the last 30 years of the computer. And I can remember my first computer was many, many, longer than 30 years ago, was a little Macintosh, and it had a mouse. And the hand-eye coordination, trying to get that mouse to work, was impossible. It was really, really frustrating. Then we had to learn how to get the information into the computer. Worse yet, we had to try to figure out how to get the information out. And I would venture to guess there's probably some people here that still aren't very comfortable with some of the computers. I mean, my husband still has a flip phone. But he just doesn't want to even move into the new phones with all the bells and whistles. So you think about that during 1900 to about 1930 with the automobile. It's the same kind of technology that changed the lives of people, changed society, changed everything around that was going on at the time. And we had to learn, and the people then had to learn how to use it. And there were special technicians that were specializing in this new technology. And moving it, and as you were born into it, it became more comfortable, and driving became more mainstream. And something that we take for granted today was very foreign to a lot of people at this time. And like I said, nothing was standardized. That Daimler that I showed you before that we have in the museum, it has two brake pedals, one for the right side and one for the left side. So just think about if you have a panic stop, you got to make sure that you're putting either even pressure, or you got to know the car well enough that if it's grabbing a little bit harder on one side than the other, you got to modulate it. I always tell people it's the rudders on the car, but the accelerator is in the middle. And on that same line, look at a Model T. Model T is like, for me, is like learning another language. Whenever I have to drive one, get into one to demonstrate it or drive it, I have to really think about it and concentrate, because if I do want to do something in a panic and I hit that center pedal, I'm actually throwing it into reverse. So this is not an easy thing. Now with everything pretty much standardized, with the exception of the new cars, with everything up here on the steering wheel, it's kind of a strange thing. But the technology back then was very, very different. And you know, as such, these gentlemen, again, as I said, did not fraternize. They didn't go between class structures. And well, you know, except on Downton, of course, they did a little bit of that. And if you haven't seen the show, I'm not going to tell you. So let's move on to a beautiful, beautiful car that is seen in very early on in the program. And I'm going to touch on it because it's a very significant car for this age, for this time frame. The first star car we are introduced early on in the show is a 1911 1216 Landaulet limousine made by Renault. Renault, which was a French company, French automotive company that was formed in 1899, was already a household word of luxury vehicles by the time Lord Grantham would have acquired the vehicle. The Renault was a symbol of wealth and taste for the fashionable society. The Model 12 CV was introduced by Renault in 1906, just as Louis Renault became the sole owner of the company following the death of his brother. Louis is credited for developing detachable spark plugs, hydraulic shock absorbers, and he perfected the carburetor, all of which were adopted by automakers both in Europe and in America. You will notice the car has a really distinctive radiator. It's actually a bulkhead mounted radiator back here with this sloping hood. It has beautiful brass appointments and has a lot of carriage lines to it. If you took that front end off of that, you could really hook a horse up to it and go down the road. But it's just beautifully made. They were finely crafted and just gorgeous. If you see them in person, they're very, very, they're very pretty cars. They were powered by a four-cylinder, 2.4-liter L-head engine. And of course, like most cars of the day, had a four-speed manual transmission. A little known fact, we're going to relate this back to the Titanic, that a 1912 Renault CB Coupe de Ville was being shipped back to Pennsylvania aboard the Titanic and by a wealthy businessman, and it sank. It did not come back. However, the gentleman who owned the car did survive, having got a seat on the last boat that left the ship. And the reason why we know this is because he was awarded a $5,000 settlement for the car by the insurance company Lloyd's of London. It's a lot of money in 1912, I mean in that time. And there's another, this is a different car. This is one in the, it's got a red color to it. There were two of them seen in the show during the Christmas season, during the Christmas episode between season one and two, the Christmas special. They were going to Scotland, and you'll see two of them arriving at the castle. They're beautiful, beautiful cars, as you can see here, very elegant. One of the fun characters in the show is Martha Levinson, who is the American mother of Lord Grantham's wife, Cora. She represents American wealth and what they termed new money, coming from Newport, Rhode Island. She loved to openly make fun of the British aristocracy and the stiff upper lip, the class system, and their rigid traditions, as she's called them, calling them snobbish and antiquated. Yet Mrs. Levinson didn't seem to notice that she enjoyed the same comforts as her English relatives, such as chauffeurs and personal maids and butlers. And she arrives in England, but does she employ a Rolls Royce or rent one to chauffeur her around? She's showing a little bit of U.S. snobbery herself. She refuses to give in to anything English, and arriving in an American car, you notice it's a left-hand drive, a 1924 Cadillac V63. The Cadillac V63 was an improved version of Cadillac's famous L-head V8 engine. The engine improved smoothness and balance, and you'll hear me say that a lot about the luxury cars. They really wanted them to be smooth and quiet. That's what these automakers kept trying to improve, smoothness and quiet of ride, as well as endurance and other parts of other factors. But when you're up in this kind of price range for these cars, these were exorbitant, very, very spendy cars for the time, you wanted a comfortable ride. The car also featured from Cadillac front brakes and rear brakes, which help stop the car, because these cars are heavy, and generally speaking, you only have them on the back, and believe me, you really got to think ahead if you're trying to get these to slow down or stop. The car, the V63, was available in 13 body styles, and the limousine could be ordered at a whopping sum of $4,600. The Levinsons in Downton represent America at a time when massive wealth was being generated in just one generation. Americans at this time had a share of aristocracy in the form of industry, roads, railroads, oil, land, and timber. Names like Morgan, Astor, Vanderbilt, Carnegie were all just a few of the people that earned their wealth in one generation and were some of the wealthy Americans that emulated English aristocracy by building lavish castles and estates in setting fashion and creating headlines. We see some beautiful mansions right here in this vicinity. The one I just toured, the Oliver Mansion this morning, what a fantastic jewel you have in this town. That's having everything there that was left in the house is just marvelous. I was telling the gentleman this morning that we don't, in the West Coast, you see houses like that have been, sometimes they get handed down to generation and generation, and then they're left to go to rack and ruin, and some lovely group of people start a foundation and then raise funds and they build it. But they have to put everything back in. And you don't know if it's the original thing, maybe it might be some of it, but some of it is a recreation. Having everything exactly, the silverware, the dishes and everything, is just wonderful. I was really enjoying it. In America, this wealth, this new wealth, was buying a lot of cars from England. As I said, that Renault was coming over, and they were also buying a lot of Rolls Royces. But you know, we see a lot of Rolls Royces depicted in Downton Abbey, including, you know, Anthony Strallon, one of the characters that was a suitor, was driving his Silver Ghost Tourer. Lady Rosamond, who is the sister of Lord Grantham, in her beautiful yellow, you'll recognize it because it's yellow. It's a Rolls Royce Phantom 1. And there's also many other Rolls Royces that we see running throughout the series. This was the top of the line of vehicles, fine vehicles in England at the time. And by Henry Royce designed the Rolls Royce Silver Ghost, which to replace his earlier models with something more reliable that ran smoother and quieter. He succeeded so completely that the new car, the Silver Ghost, became the longest running single model next to the Model T, and certainly the most famous luxury car in history. Today, Silver Ghosts are one of the most desirable cars among collectors of pre-war era luxury vehicles. But you know, I think there's a little, I have to bring this back to America, because there is, in 1919, because Rolls-Royce could see that they had a good market here in America, incorporated as Rolls-Royce of America, and acquired its first plant in Springfield, Massachusetts. They were trying to compete with the local, with the American market now, with automakers that were taking market share away from them, such as Crane Simplex and other luxury auto builders and coach builders here in the United States. Production began in the following year, but by 1923, Rolls-Royce presence in America was substantial. Rolls-Royce of America manufactured nearly 3,000 Silver Ghosts and Phantoms before succumbing to the Great Depression. To this day, Springfield, Massachusetts is the only place outside of England where Rolls-Royces were ever built. And I have one in my collection here, and I say it's my collection, and in the collection at LeMay America's Car Museum. I'm gonna just show it to you so you can see something that was made in the United States. It looks very much like a Rolls-Royce, the Silver Ghost, but they call them Springfield Rolls-Royces because they are documented as being built in America. And this one is a fun one for me because I did trace this back to its original owner. I could do an entire program for you on this one. It's the woman was just coach building. Because when you bought a car of this stature, you would buy the car, the Rolls Royce, the power plant, the running gear, the suspension, everything from the cowl forward, and then you would be given a selection of coach builders and styles that you could put on the back part, the part that you rode in. So you could have an open car, you could have a closed car, you have one that roll up windows, you could have a Phaeton or a sport coupe, perhaps with a rumble seat. Whatever you desired and that they offered for the car, you could order it. And then the company would send it to the coach builder and they would build the part that you sit in. Oops, back here, gotta go back here. That would be right here. So this one, the 1926 Rolls-Royce Silver Ghost Limousine, has a Tilbury body style by Willoughby & Company. And Willoughby & Company was a coach builder here in the United States and built a fair amount of vehicles for Rolls-Royce. And I traced this one back to, I was lucky enough to find the records. I kept digging around, finding the records. The Rolls-Royce Club of America helped me find some records, and we discovered this car was owned by a woman in Portland, Oregon. She made her money, actually her husband had come across on the Oregon Trail, made his money in lumber, was very, very wealthy, but she had made her money in her own right. She was an amazing person, very progressive, and she held the patent for the electric curling iron. The electric curling iron was made in, she had a company that was producing them right in Chicago, Illinois. They were marketed at Marshall Fields and other department stores. She sold her rights to the patent in 1926, about the time that she ordered the car. And you know, you're probably going to wonder how I'm going to get this back to Downton Abbey, but I had to show you the scene where Anna and Mary had got the newfangled electric curling iron, and they were trying to make it work. So this is what's fun about Downton Abbey, because during the show, as it progresses through time, they also introduce all the new and fun things that we take for granted, like the toaster and the mixer and things like that, and the radio and the telephone. There's, it's fun watching Carson trying to figure out that candlestick phone. And so this was kind of, when I saw this scene, that made me think of Clarissa Inman. So let's go move on to the real star cars. These are the cars that were owned by the Grantham. You see them the most during the series. And the two cars here, one you see more often than the other, but the first one, the gray one on this side over here, I guess that would be your left, is a 1928 Bentley. And that one appeared in season 5 and 6. It appeared in season 5. I'm thinking the Granthams probably ordered another car. They needed another limousine because the family was growing. The daughters were getting married and having children, and they probably needed another car. But the one on the other side is a 1924 Sunbeam, which appeared in season 2 and can be seen throughout the entire series. As a matter of fact, it's probably the one that you see the most. And you saw it in the opening sequence with the cars coming up to Downton quite a bit. So let's talk about that 1924 Sunbeam. The car that we see in the show is actually a 1924 Sunbeam A20, model A20, 60 horsepower saloon. And saloon is the British term for a four-door sedan. The Sunbeam dates from 1888, first making bicycles and then motorcycles and then automobiles. And you know, that's the way most of the automobile industry went. They went from wagons, automobiles, or they started with motorcycle or bicycles, put a motor on it, went to a motorcycle, and then perhaps moved into automotive production. During World War I, Sunbeam also produced aero engines for use in military aircraft. Sunbeam cars set a number of land speed records, and the Sunbeam was the first British car to win a Grand Prix race. Lord Grantham's Sunbeam limousine is featured prominently beginning in the middle of season 2 or towards the end. And they were large, powerful, and cars quite advanced for their time. They featured a 4.5-liter engine with six-cylinder engines with aluminum pistons, and produced 60 horsepower. Sunbeam has a long and storied history and is one of Britain's most famous marks. And I wanted to show you this picture. This is Maggie Smith sitting in the back seat as she plays Lady Violet. And the reason why I wanted to show you this is because the most very distinctive feature of this car is that C-shape, the half circle look in the back window. And as you see it go by, if you see the car, that is kind of a burgundy color and with a black above the belt, and then that C window, that's going to be your Sunbeam. The other vehicle we see in the show, as I said, starting at season 5, and you know, I got to tell you, the Granthams, we're going to give them a little license here, either that or they had a time machine to transport their cars, because the 28 Bentley that we see there appeared in season 5, which was actually started in 1924, and the 24 Sunbeam, which we saw at, you know, kind of the middle to the end of season 2, actually season 2 ended in 1919. This particular 1929 Bentley Salmon Sports Saloon with a Tickford wind-down top, you have no idea how long I practiced that one. That was a tough one. It had, in real life, has a real fun story. It has a name. It's called the Gray Lady. I think I've got a better picture of it here. I love this picture. They posed all the characters around sitting on the Gray Lady. The owner is James Metcalf, who acted as chauffeur during the filming and is featured in seasons 5 and 6, and Mr. Metcalf is the president of the Bentley Owners Association in England. This particular car I had discovered. I have a friend in England that I spoke to who actually worked on some of the filming of the race sequences towards the end of the season, of the season 6, and he gave me some inside information about this particular car and has a wonderful story. It seems that the car was found by the owner, the first owner who restored it, his name was Douglas Simmons, in the middle of a farm near his home in England. The gentleman had his own private collection, and he also had his own little garage where he did his restoration and service of his own collection of cars. But when he found this car, he bought it from the farmer, and the farmer was using it as a chicken coop. He brought the car back to his garage and was actually warned not to restore it. It was too far gone not to restore it. But he had faith in the car. He kind of knew what he had, and he did it anyway. This was about in the middle of the 20th century, sometime around late 50s, early 60s. When he was selling his collection off, he offered it to Mr. Metcalf, who bought the car, because he knew he would preserve the car and keep it as it is. And Mr. Metcalf and his family has driven the car all over the world, including across South Africa and on tours across Death Valley in the United States. It's also appeared at the Pebble Beach Motoring Classic Pebble Beach Concours d'Elegance, among other concours. It won its best car outside of North America around 1980. It's said to be the only one of its kind left, and the Tickford wind-down top works perfectly. And let me break that down for you again. You see the name, 1929 Bentley. So that's the name of the automaker. Salmon, Sports Saloon. Salmon is the coach builder. Salmon was a company that made very few bodies for Bentley. They were located near the Bentley Cricklewood plant, but they didn't make very many of them, so that's made it extremely rare. And Tickford was the company that developed these wind-down tops for cars. And if you try to get these tops down on these big sedans like this, they're really kind of ungainly to do. They're very hard to peel back. You need several people, and you've got to keep it straight and make sure you have it all going in the right direction. But this one, with the winding mechanism, you put a key somewhere in the fender there. I haven't seen it demonstrated, but they were trying to explain it to me over the phone. And it cranks down and folds back down. So if the driver or the person that owned the car wanted the chauffeur to have an open day, they wanted to drive in the beautiful sunshine, they could easily wind it down with one person. The car current owner does lend the car out to other filming, and you can see this car in Foyle's War and also in Mr. Selfridge, other PBS programs. Here's a side picture. You can see the top, how it winds down. It has the roll-up windows that stay in place, but the top will roll down. The onset of World War I slowed and in some cases stopped altogether automotive production in favor of the war effort. Not completely though, like we did during World War II, but very much so in many cases. And I mentioned before how Studebaker did serve the war effort in England by filling orders from the British government. But during this time and following the war, we saw expansion and advancements made in the automobile both in Europe and in America. The 1920s saw a rapid expansion of private driving. The number of car licenses in Britain rose from 187,000 in 1920 to nearly 500,000 by 1924 and 1 million by 1930. Yet the density of cars is kind of interesting to me. The density of cars lagged far behind us in the United States because there was one motor car for every 76 residents in England. And by comparison here in the United States, there was one automobile for every 7 residents. And that level was not reached in Britain until 1963. Following the war changed British society, changed the way they looked at things, and the young people coming back to the from the war had different ideas, and it led us into the Roaring Twenties. And you know, the Roaring Twenties was aptly named because fast was fashionable in all things, including cars. It was written during this time that cars are sexy, beautiful creations that promise a world of speed and freedom. But you know, cars were also a symbol at the time of risk and danger. Improvements to motor cars made them more powerful and faster every year. Young men who had returned from World War I, had modern ideas and independence. Not willing to be chauffeured around, they wanted to drive their own cars. Young men and women purchased new and sportier and powerful vehicles. British automakers came out in full force, as they did here in the United States, with racing on their minds. And in Downton, we see Matthew and Mary Crawley racing across the countryside, returning home in their sporty AC Light 6 that Matthew had just purchased, to which Lord Grantham stated, well, at least it's English. The AC, which stands for Auto Carriers Limited, following the war, added the Light 6 model, which was equipped with a newly developed Weller overhead cam six-cylinder engine, and it was nimble and fast and was said to sustain high speeds needed for motoring and racing. By the time Matthew would have purchased this car, the AC had already been winning numerous speed and endurance records all across Europe. And they were racing for a reason. These companies put together race teams and were putting these, you can see this car looks just like that one. I mean, that was one that you could buy, but this is one that you raced. I mean, it was the same model. They took these and put them out on the road or in endurance races such as that later came on later, like Le Mans, and they would race these cars to gain prominence and name for themselves. And that way, if you heard about the car and created a name, it had a record, you would go out and perhaps order one and buy one, because you could buy it just, you know, almost the one that raced. And if you wanted to, you could buy the car and you could go race it yourself. The car that we see here in real life is a 1924 AC6. Again, the Crawley time machine, you know, is kind of coming into that, because shockingly and sadly, the AC that Matthew was so proud to show Lord Grantham was Matthew's demise at the end of season 3. Shockingly, a lot of people quit watching the show after season 3 when they killed Matthew off, but he was racing the car across the countryside to be with Mary at the death of their son. W.O. Bentley had great success in engineering and building World War I aero engines for the British war effort. After the war, W.O. and H.M. Bentley turned their focus into manufacturing fine automobiles and founded the Bentley Motors Limited in 1919 and located the business in Cricklewood, North London. Despite their size and weight, the Bentley 3-liter won Le Mans in 1924 and made its mark as a genuine sports car. It was a complete contrast to the much smaller and lighter Bugattis that were associated with racing during this time. Bentley unfortunately went into receivership, but was purchased by Rolls-Royce in 1931, but not before winning 5 championship wins at Le Mans. And the 4.5-liter version that came out a little bit later in the production were wins in 1928, 29, and 30. Some racing 4.5-liter Bentleys were capable of speeds of 100 miles an hour and up to 130 in full racing form. Bentley sold 720 copies of the 4.5-liter, and 655 of them were naturally aspirated, and they made 55 with superchargers. Von & Plus Limited is a coach builder that built bodies for Bentley bodies, and this is a Von & Plus tourer. They built over 700 bodies for Bentley tourers between 1924 and 1931, and the body was comprised of a wood framework that was covered by a padded leatherette. And generally speaking, they were always, or usually, British racing green in color. So popular were these bodies that many original Bentley chassis have been rebodied in their likeness, and are an extremely collectible and popular today. So the car that we see first when Henry Talbot comes onto the scene, he comes driving up and makes his impression on Mary. He's driving this Bentley right here. It's actually in real life, a 1926 Bentley 3-liter Von & Plus Tourer. And in the racing sequence, it was actually car number 10. So you want to remember car number 10. And later on, he sells this car in season 6. He sells this very car to, and you see it right there, is number 10. That's a screenshot I grabbed off the video of the racing season series. And he sells this car to Charlie, his friend, who again races it. Then we have this car. This is car number 14. But there's Henry Talbot driving it up again to the front of Downton Abbey. This car is a 1923 Bentley Vanden Plas two-seater with a Dickey seat, so it has a rumble seat. And it's currently, the car currently is fitted with a 4.5-liter engine, and it has these unique little scuttle vents. I don't know if you can see them up here. Those are air intakes. It's kind of an interesting feature for this car. And there it is in its racing form, number 14. It's actually being driven. It's not being driven by Henry. It's being driven by the driver, the owner of the car, made up to look like Henry. So we're going to talk about, you know, during season 5 and 6, they talk about Brooklyn's racing a lot. They refer to it very frequently, and it was a big deal back then. So for having it shown in the series, I was really excited that they went to this part in the story, that Julian Fellowes actually developed this part of the series into the history portion of the show, because the Brooklyn's has a very, very interesting history, and I have... I wanted to tell you just a little bit about it, since they refer to it a lot, but they don't really tell you a lot about it. Brooklands was a 2.75 mile racing track in Surrey. Let's see if I can get the picture. Here it is. This is a vintage picture of Brooklands Raceway. About 25 miles south of London. It opened in 1907, but hosted its last race in 1939. It was a banked cement raceway, and there were outer circuit cars. Those were the ones that had the power to be able to get up on the sides high enough to run around the outside of the track. And there were also inner circuit cars. Those were slower cars, and many times they would have races running concurrently with different classes. So you'd have your outer circuit cars running around the top, and you'd have your inner circuit cars running around the bottom. It must have been just a mad place to be racing. I just can't imagine. The other thing I want to point out to you is that people just stood along the side. I mean, there's no barriers. There's nothing. They would just throw their picnic baskets down and have great race day with the cars just blaring by them, and, you know, hope that they didn't run off the track or miss the curb, because they would have issues with that if that happened. Here's a picture of what it looks like today. Unfortunately, it was closed in 1939. It was heavily bombed in certain parts of it during the war, and it never came back. It was never rebuilt. The part of a roadway, a highway, now goes through part of the area where the track was. But they have preserved part of the roadway. They do have vintage meets here, and there's a wonderful museum located and dedicated to racing on the property, and where I got a few of these vintage pictures. They were very generous to share them with me. I have to share this picture. This has nothing to do with Downton Abbey, but I had to show you this. I got this from the museum. This is a picture of a very famous race where this gentleman, John Cobb, in 1935 was racing this Napier, and he broke the speed, or he set a speed record of 144 miles an hour. And I think this is where the term flying down the track comes from, because not one wheel is on that cement. And
6, driven by Sir Patrick Axford, is withdrawn. What looks like radiator trouble. Oh dear, it looks like Sir Patrick has blown a gasket too.
But don't you envy them?
No, I don't.
Nor me. Jill, you're going to have to keep an eye on Tom.
Well, there is something gallant and daring in it. Even I can see that. Shaping up to be a tight battle for the winner's laurels. And what's this? Oliver Caudle's number 8 Bentley is slowing down. Yes, it's pulled into the side of the track. Looks like steering trouble. There goes Rogers. Charlie Rogers has taken the lead. And now look, Henry Talbot in car number 14 is going to try to snatch that lead away from him. He's already overturned the bike.
Very, very excited when they came up with when I saw that they were going to have a racing sequence at the end of this series. So I wanted to talk to you about, you saw number 14 and number 10 racing. Those are the two Bugattis. So, but they also did something that was really fun when I realized that they included the Le Mans start at the beginning of the race. This was so authentic for the time. They could have just started the race and nobody would know. They didn't explain it. They didn't talk about it. But for those that because we don't do that anymore, but for those that know, this was the way they started. This is the way they started to equalize a race. Was the cars would be positioned on one side, and the drivers would be all the way across the other side of the track. The cars would be turned off, cold, brake set, and they'd have to drop a flag, and they'd run like heck across the way, and they'd jump in, try to get this car started. And if any of you have a vintage car and try to get it started when you want it to start, sometimes it doesn't always work. They have to get it started, get it primed, ready to go, start, release the brake, and blast off, or as my English friend would say, hair off, and run down the road. And it was really fun to see that depicted here. Now, it really comes, the term Le Mans start actually comes from the race that is held in Le Mans, France, every year. It started in 1923. And actually, these starts were very, very unsafe. And as later years came on, where they had safety equipment, seat belts. These gentlemen don't have seat belts, and they're not wearing helmets. But later on, they started adding safety equipment. And when they started adding the safety equipment, the gentlemen would be hurrying, rushing to start get in the car and start. And they would either fail to get things connected correctly, or they would altogether just not do it. And it was causing problems, because if they had an accident or a wreck, people were getting killed. So they quit the Le Mans start sometime in the 70s, let's see, 1970, because more and more helmets and things, more and more equipment was being required. So let's talk about some of these cars. I'm going to have, I've got some behind the scenes things to share with you too. As I said, it was the most expensive scene that they created. And first of all, this is the lineup. This is actually, this is not a filming, this is behind the scenes. So you'll see some people in non-period dress as well. This was filmed, the racing sequences were filmed at Goodwood Circuit, which is a very famous racing circuit that's just south of London. And they dressed up the grandstand to have a vintage look to it, replaced all the advertising and logos with period correct advertising. They hung burlap, big sheets of burlap behind just to block off, because if you look through there, you can see modern pits and modern equipment and signage. And right here we have the cars that you're looking at. Number 8 is a fun one. That was actually a 1926 Bentley, and it actually raced Le Mans. It was the only car shown that was an actual Le Mans works entry, but it didn't finish its race in that year because of engine issues. It's a worked car is a term for a car that was campaigned by the company, the manufacturer. So this was a Bentley team that was raced by Bentley. My car is owned by the same gentleman that owned the Tickford, or the Salmon Sports Saloon that we talked about, and he drove it during the race sequences. The other two cars, you see that number 12? That's a Vauxhall. You'll be able to remember it later because of the distinctive hood. It's got that little scallop in the hood, and it's red. But that's a British car. But the what's fun about this one that I found out from my friend Mark Andrews, who has a garage and worked, actually he ferried cars back and forth and worked on the sequences. He told me that that Vauxhall has a V8 Hispano Suiza Aero engine, so it actually has an airplane engine in it. So I'd love to hear that thing go by. It must have been really fun. Some of the other cars you see, number 10 and number 14 in the background, those are the two star cars we've already talked about. And then some of the other fun ones that I was able to ID. I was going through these lists trying to ID these pictures because they didn't do it in the show. But you see down here, the Bugatti Type 35, there were several Bugattis featured throughout this race sequence. And I'm showing that one because it's owned by a lady, a French woman. She drove it, dressed her up as a man, but she drove it in the series. The Riley, and then up here we have this one took me the longest one to try to ID. I couldn't figure it out. It's a 1911 Scat Type C. That's an Italian make. I don't know much about them, I'm sorry. And then we have the 1913 Vauxhall, which is number 12. The thing also I'd like to share with you, there's some fun little backstory. We have on the racing, the gentlemen that drove the cars were the owners. They were not going to, they decided it was really actually more safer and beneficial to have the owners operate their own cars because all of these cars are owned by people who race them. These gentlemen maintain these cars, they take them out to vintage racing and operate them. It was safer and better all the way around. The car sequences, they used makeup on the track. They called it makeup, but when the skid marks and all the track along the track were charcoal that was painted on, and they would brush it off, do the seaming, put it back on, and brush it off. It was a lot of effort
Picture of her Rolls-Royce with Edith just stepping off the train.
And, you know, if you watch the show, you remember Edith wanted to learn how to drive, and Tom taught her how to drive. But this is how they filmed those sequences. They put that Renault, they lashed that Renault onto a lowboy trailer and was pulled around by a semi-truck while Tom and Edith did their learning to drive. And there's all the apparatus, all the camera work there filming away. So I'm going to leave you with Carson. Of course, we have to stop. If we're going to stop anything, we have to stop with Carson. And one of my favorite quotes from Carson is, "The business of life is the acquisition of memories." And I hope that we've built some memories for you today. Thank you for coming to see me speak to you. It's been my honor to be here. And if you come to Tacoma, I hope that you'll come visit me at LeMay America's Car Museum. And if you're a Studebaker person, the 2018 Studebaker Nationals are going to be held at our museum. I'm very proud to have that there. And come, if you do come by, make sure you look me up and say hello and that you saw me here. So thank you very much. It's been my pleasure.